rest. And the night has no end. There's hope for your hurting heart. For he'll be there with you no matter what you're going through. God still answers
Son, God still answers prayer. And this song, it's kind of coincidental they go together, I guess, because two things that that I've learned a lot from Miss Ima Jean has been this, is that God does answer prayer. I've seen her be a woman of faith. But you know, she always, if you ever talk to Miss Ima Jean, one thing she always talks about, well, when you think about the Lord, when you talk about the Lord, when you're in the Lord's Word. And I appreciate people that really look at life by looking through the Lord's Word. Amen. And I want Miss Ima Jean, you just share what's on your heart. I appreciate you.
I know for a fact that God really does answer prayer. He brought me from the country, a poor girl that had no shoes, hardly had any clothes, to where I am now. It was only God. My mom was a very strong Christian woman. My dad was a preacher, and he preached and sang all over, but it was in the day where they didn't get paid. And he would leave us, and we would hardly have nothing to eat. But God can do miracles. He has done some for me. I just want people to believe in God. That's all. That will get the job done. If we have faith in God, He'll do whatever. He'll do whatever we need doing. I'm glad that He has showed Himself to me in a billion ways, and He's never failed me.
solid ground. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about you want me to.
only said, I'll never go alone. So when the whole world turns against me and I'm all by myself and I can't hear you answer my cries for help, if you want me to. Yes, I'll go through the fire if you want me to.
I wanted to be able to come, and if we could, I'd like to have maybe some of the teenage girls. I don't know, Miss Taylor, if y'all could find that. I want to sing that song, God's Been Good. You know, there's been a lot of songs that we sing that are new, and some songs that we sing that we haven't sung in a long time. Some songs we used to sing all the time. And two of the songs that really used to always make a great difference to me is not just that God's been good, but also we sang another song that talked about how we live in a country and how He given us the very things that we need to be able to live and shoes on our feet. And you know, one thing I've learned, that a heart of gratitude is a heart of worship. Listen, don't get distracted by these teenagers. Listen to me. If your worship's not what it needs to be, you might not have the gratitude in your heart that you should have. It's easy to worship the Lord when you have gratitude and appreciation. You believe that? Say amen. And I liked what Miss Ima Jean said a while ago. She said, you know, I was just a country girl that God's just kind of kept. You know, think back where God's brought you from. Think back how many times that God has moved mountains and answered prayer and met needs. And here we are tonight, we're very blessed, and God has been very good to us. This church, with all due respect, has got an identity established in this community that whether you know it or not, and thank God that you don't, some of you don't even, you're clueless to know how many pivotal moments we've had in Haines Baptist Church over the last 5 to 6 years. Y'all hear me when I say that? Some of you're clueless. You know how many times the devil could have split this church? And you know, you're thinking right now, are you serious? Did I miss something? Absolutely, that's called grace. We missed it. Everybody all right? Y'all wake up, smell the coffee, go to Starbucks. It's on me next time, all right? And if you wonder if I'm jacked up on coffee, I didn't even get to drink my coffee. Somebody say amen. God has been so faithful, so faithful. And I look back to all the years, all the times, all the prayers that's been asked and answered, and how God has orchestrated so many things. God knows, God sees what we don't. But as we look back, God has been good and God has been faithful. Have we all been what we needed to be? Absolutely not, including myself. Man, there's been many times God took my mess and just, I don't know how He put it together, but thank God He did. But we're still standing. Amen. I remember in 2000, the preachers were saying, you better put all your stuff up and get all your money. Why? Because Jesus is going to come back. And you know what? With all due respect, people that knew the Bible went out and did exactly what that was, knowing that that's not the Bible. That's not here. And so many times we have been wavered. We've went back and forth. We've been persuaded by government, by elections, by financial things in life and circumstances. Y'all know I'm telling it right. We've been manipulated by society, by hardships, by mountains, by valleys, by divorces, by divisions, by discord, by disgruntled people and people that's literally shown their face when Satan has halted us and taunted us. We've been distracted. But we can still say on this night in 2016 that I might be holding on, but thank God even when I've let go, He's still holding on to me. Amen? And God is good. And this generation needs to know that God is good and God is faithful. And I know changes have been hard, and I know changes have been difficult. I know that there's been different people that's come and go, and people that sung, and leadership of things that we saw. But listen, that just shows you God is not put all in a man. God is bigger than us. God's bigger than me. God's bigger than you. God's bigger than the ministry that you and I serve in. We serve a God that's faithful. There's some of you that's here tonight. You've walked away and come back, and God's just as big as He was before you ever went anywhere. We ought to thank Him tonight. Just praise Him for what He's done. Mind the Lord and say, God, you know what? I don't have it all figured out, but I know if you did it before, you'll do it again. And God, whether you do it or not, you're still good. Let God encourage you. Just mind the Lord as they sing. Second verse, you testify, Rachel.
I haven't been able to come to church.
Hey, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me. Just be real. It's all right. Okay? It's all right.
And that's been really hard, because it's hard to keep reading your Bible, keep trying to love God when you can't go to church and hear the word. But I thank God that I have brothers that can take me when they're able to. And you know, today in the morning last night I was like, God, will you please let me go to church today? Like, this morning I woke up too late. And I felt pretty bad, but tonight I'm here. I mean, but I just want to thank God, because, you know, sometimes I get down and I'm like, God, where are you? Why aren't you allowing me to go to church? Why isn't this happening? But He's just like, Rachel, I'm here with you right now. I'm here. And sometimes I may not feel it, but I know He's there, because I'm here tonight. I just want to thank God for that. He's there in the Bible, even when I can't go to church. Thank God for the Bible. I just want to thank God for that.
You know, we take for granted sometimes, church, teenagers, mom and dad, that we don't have to worry about how we're going to get to church. Some of you kids got mom and dads that they'll drag you to church. I wonder what we'd have felt like this morning if we were worried about whether we're going to make it or not. I know it seems to be simple, and it's probably something we can't even fathom. But you know, there's people that's beyond her that's still sitting out there. There's drunkards that's waking up on a Sunday morning thinking, I wonder if I can get back to church today. Who's going to reach them? Who's going to love them to get here? Who's going to just let them sit out there and wallow in their mess or actually go out there and get dirty and say, you know what? You still matter to the Lord because I still matter to the Lord. That's what it's all about right there. Never take for granted. Every service you might think, you know, I'm tired, I'm wore out, things are happening. I understand that. But thank God, God's still good to us. Amen. You mind the Lord. Y'all sing that second verse. Good job. A few verses tonight, and before I do, let me start by reading this verse. The Bible says, and let's start reading. I'll read myself in Proverbs chapter number 18, verse number 21. Listen to this. Stay in James. I want to read one verse. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. God, I want you to use me. But death and life is in the power of the tongue. God, I want to be a blessing to somebody. Why ain't I being a blessing? Because you haven't learned that death and life is in the power of the tongue. But why are so many people around me disgruntled, and why am I not really making a difference like I used to? Lord, I'm struggling. Because you look right, you dress right, you come to church right. But you haven't learned that death and life is in the power of your tongue. Yes, sir. Right. Just because you look good don't mean that you're serving well. Right. And just because you dress right and just because you speak right when you come to church don't mean that God's going to use you in a great way. Truth be told, our public life is not what it needs to be because our private life is not what it ought to be. But we'll live publicly right when we start living privately right. Somebody say amen. I want God to use me. I want God to give me the right friends, give me the right companion, give me the right wife, give me the right husband. I want God to be able to help me at church, and maybe God use me to be able to preach or teach or be able to sing. Sometimes people ain't allowed to have a microphone to sing a song, because the same mouth that they use to sing and worship the Lord is the same mouth that they use to cuss and cause slander and discord and discomfort for other people. Amen. And you wonder why there's no authority on your life. You wonder why there's no impact that you're making. You wonder why it's such a struggle. But sometimes we have to slow down and realize that the power of the tongue has death and life within itself. Even today, as simple as it was, speaking to that lady, I know we didn't say a lot about just Jesus, if you will, but this woman finds out she has cancer, invites her to church. Do you know how encouraging that is to people, just to be able to realize that there's still hope, knowing that somebody's still preaching and teaching about the goodness of God, even though the devil is fighting every single day? Why? Because the greatest instrument you have, it's not your Bible, that's God's. It's not your word, that's His word. And He's faithful to His word. And He's true to His word. And everything in His word will come to pass. But it's not God's word that we're evaluating. It's your words to come out of your mouth. The Bible says this in James chapter number 3. My brethren, he's not talking to the lost man. He's talking to the independent, fundamental, King James Version, you know, pre-trib, virgin birth, knowing everything, washed in the blood, sanctified by the blood, glorified by the blood, rose. He's going on. He knows that he's saved to the uttermost. That's who he's talking. He's talking to those of us that are the Sunday night, the Wednesday night, those of us that know the words of my brethren. He's talking to those that say they're saved. Amen. Truth be told, I'll be quite frank with you. I never had a problem before I got saved, people talking to me about the way it was. Either somebody getting upset, they get in a fight, they get right, they walk away, they go around somewhere else, they get tore up. Hey, I heard one man say it this way, it's the truth. Two drunks get along sometimes better than two Christians. Amen. I'm just being plain with you. I'm not promoting that by no means, and I'm not saying go out and live that lifestyle. Don't get quiet on me, but I will say this. Don't be hypocritical by thinking you got it all figured out, but you by all means are still negative with your mouth.
That's right.
And let me just say it this way. If you ain't got a problem with cussing, that don't mean that God's not talking to you. If you don't have a problem with lashing out at people, that don't mean God's not telling you. But if you got a problem with saying things that causes division and discord and slander, then that means God is talking to you. And that means sometimes, and I just want to say this, I'm not addressing an issue. Everybody all right? Say amen. Everybody all right? Say amen. I'm not addressing no issue. Just because you don't understand what's going on in the church don't make you to have the right to be able to speak about something you don't know about. If you want to know, the Bible says be able to go to somebody, talk to somebody. That's what you ought to do. That's what you ought to do. We want our children to live right, to act right, dress right. They want to be able to perform right, do all these things that they want to do. And man, they got it down pat. They know, God forbid that I go to church, and I'm not mocking, so don't get mad at me. God forbid that I go to church and not wear a skirt. My mom and daddy will kill me. Praise the Lord, they know modesty. Amen. But then the issues we're dealing with is not them wearing a skirt. It's them jacking their jaws because they hear their mom and daddy doing it. You want to know why we're having issues? It ain't because the skirts ain't right, and the ties ain't right, and the dress ain't right, and the Bible ain't right. It's because the mouth ain't right. You want to know why a lot of people don't want to come to church, and why a lot of them don't want to come to church with us? Because they hear our mouth. They hear what we do. They hear what we sing. They hear what we laugh about. Oh yes, oh yes. They hear the things that we watch and we speak of. And let me just say it this way, friend. I'm not worried about who across the church knows your personal life. I want you to look at those two or three or four or five that you run around with all the time. I wonder how many of them know that you hang out with them because they know how you are and they don't judge you. The best thing is maybe you do get judged based upon the Word of God. Maybe. Maybe we understand that a true friend, as we've been preaching on David, so we don't just say hallelujah one week and be silent next week, that a true friend is a friend that keeps somebody accountable. What's the way you speak and you talk, the way you act, the songs that you sing. The songs that you sing. It's amazing to me how many people say, I don't like to sing, or they'll drop out of the choir, drop in the choir. They'll be lackadaisical in the choir, or they'll be in the choir one week and out of the choir the next week, but you put them in a car playing their kind of music and they'll know every word and sing it every day. They still got a song in their heart, but the problem is the meditation in their heart ain't what it needs to be, and it's not about God, it's about self. Amen. And you want to know why you're struggling. You want to know why you have an issue. You want to know why we get bogged down so much. It's because we can't control our tongue. We can't control our mouth. So he says, members, he said, listen to this. Verse number 2, for in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same as a perfect man. He's not saying he's perfect. That's not what he's speaking as far as our term of perfect, like Jesus or like God. He's not talking about Adam before sin. He says perfect, to be mature. A man that speaks right is a mature man, a mature lady. Somebody that knows how to say something when they need to say something and learn to keep their mouth shut when they need to keep their mouth shut. And listen, I love Jesus and I love you, but just because you're old and you've been saved for 10 years, 5 years, or you're the oldest in the youth group, or you're the oldest in the church, or you got gray hair, that don't give you the right to speak your mind when you want to. A submissive person is submissive at all times. Control your tongue. A maturity is found in the way you speak. And sometimes it's not by what you say. Your maturity might be established in what you don't say. He says, if any man offend not the word, the same as a perfect man, and also and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold, also the ships, which though they be so great, so massive, large, if you will, they are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm. Whithersoever the governor listeth, even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. You understand how damaging, how detrimental, how rough that your mouth can be, how one word of something you say can destroy somebody. Amen. We want this generation to be vibrant and serve the Lord with urgency and just be excited about going on for God every day of their life, not knowing that our passive little comments about how this generation ain't got it figured out, and how this generation is so spoiled, and this generation is so ruined, and this generation don't know what it's about. Do you know that that little fire kindleth a great matter? Do you ever think of how many teenagers never darken the door when they graduate high school because they got burned with a little fire? And I understand, y'all. I'm like you. You know, I look at some of these kids and some of these young adults and some other people as my own children. Some people older than me, I even look at them by trying to help them. But let me just say it this way. Just because you have good intentions don't make you right for speaking your mind, even though it might be a biblical principle. Well, let me back up. I've used this illustration a whole lot over the past few weeks. And let's just go back to Peter again. Here Peter was using his human thinking. Jesus is down. He's getting ready to be taken. And because he did not acknowledge what the Bible said or what God had already spoke, what did he do? He reached out and he cut the man's ear off. Why? Because humanly thinking, he thought, I need to defend Jesus. I need to stand up for Jesus. I need to be the one to fill the gap. I need the one to be able to stand up when nobody else was. And the truth be told, he was out of God's will. I wonder how many of us has literally cut somebody's ear off with our tongue. I'm not saying this. I understand, and I know I'm meddling by metal because we got to make it right. We got to make it plain with everything. So listen to me when I say this. Stay with me. You know, a lot of times we think that the older women are supposed to be able to help the younger. Well, by the way, that's Bible. Older men are supposed to help the younger men. That's Bible. Everybody with me say amen. But that don't give you the authority to say what you want, when you want, how you want, and control somebody's life. And just because you're passionate about something and somebody else ain't as compassionate and passionate about it as you are, don't make you more righteous than what they are. That's what makes the balance. Learn to keep your mouth shut. Amen. Why? Because lives are destroyed. You know what it feels like to call somebody one day and say, "Hey, brother so-and-so, how come you ain't been to church? Oh, we miss you. We love you. Everything going? Well, I'm doing well, but so-and-so said so-and-so, and then so-and-so, and I just don't like drama." And, you know, they're really right. Truth be told, you ruin that person because you said something. They don't even know what happened. They don't even know how it was. And here we are. We're clapping and saying hallelujah, running around the church and singing the old songs, and everything's great and hunky-dory. And we act like we got it all made and everything is just fine the way it needs to be. And somebody's sitting at home with tears running down their face, with a broken spirit, wanting to serve to God, wanting God to answer prayer. But they're so ruined because somebody couldn't control their tongue. Do you know how deadly this thing is? You know how deadly it is? The Bible says if you keep reading, "In the tongue is a fire, a word, world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, and it defileth the whole body." You understand that? Now, unless my King James Bible's wrong, it says that the tongue can ruin the whole body. Do you understand that? The interest point, the pivotal moment, the place, the one thing that hinges the entirety of your life can be controlled with this. You might be a prayer warrior. You might be somebody that fasts. You might be a good singer. You might be able to study your Bible, teach your Bible, preach the Bible. You might be able to come and teach Sunday school. You might be here for a long time. You could quote scripture and you know how to discern the right word of God. You know how to rightly divide the word of God. But the truth be told, you can't control this. He says the whole body, everything you do is it's messed up because you can't control this. You know how damaging that is? You know how scary that is? One word can ruin somebody. You want to know what I believe? I believe that a lot of times it's churches like ours that need to hear stuff like this the most because we have the most opinionated people in churches that's like ours. You know why? Because a lot of us came through the school of hard knocks. And we believe we ought to just be able to speak our mind and be able to say it and get a teaching. You know, "Hey, I got a backbone, you got a backbone, bless God." We're just going to be upfront about it. Yeah, you be upfront about it. But I hope you're upfront about when somebody says that you hurt their feelings and you're upfront enough to be able to say, "I'm sorry." Amen. And he says here that it controls the whole body. "And setteth a fire," listen, "on fire the course of nature," everything. And listen to these words. "And it is set on fire of hell." Do you understand that? That means the devil will have control of your mouth. And when the devil has control of your mouth, he can set everything in your life to be on fire, to be a ruckus. He has a heyday. You want to know why our marriages struggle, our relationship struggles, and our kids' relationship struggles, and everything else struggle? It's because we can't control our tongue. And everything is going chaotic. Everything is chaos. You know why churches split? I would dare say 90% of the time, it's not a spiritual matter. The root of it might be a spiritual matter because obviously why would anybody stand up in church if it wasn't a biblical issue? But see, the problem ain't about a church split because a church split don't ever happen from God because God's not about division. The church split happens because it's on a biblical principle, but it is defined by the Bible. But what happens is you get a bunch of long-tongued people that think they know everything. And this side believes one thing, and this side believes the other thing. And because of it, hell then sets in, splits the church wide open because of a difference of opinion on the same Bible truth. And it splits. Now, sometimes there is a real issue. But let's just be honest about it. There's a whole lot more opinions sometimes in the house of God than what there are Christians. Everybody all right? Say amen. Everybody's good. Everybody good? Praise the Lord. Starbucks is still open. We'll go back and have coffee a little bit. Ain't nothing wrong. But we don't understand. And I say this, and I'm going to try to finish and try to hurry tonight. I say this because, you know, people get discouraged, not just by what we say to them, but people get discouraged what we say about them. I mean, you know, here we are, we're talking, and we might say something to them, and you hurt their feelings, and then we're too, you know, too prideful to say, I'm sorry. But then sometimes people get discouraged because of what we say, keyword say again, what we say about them. Right. You might not say it directly to them, but you say it to somebody else about them.
Amen.
Everybody all right?
Amen.
Let me say it this way, friend. If you're saying something about somebody else and God didn't tell you to say it, whether it's a truth or not, it's still slander. Because it's out of the will of God. Come on now, y'all don't get quiet on me. But if you say it and it's based upon assumption, just because you assume don't make it right. Amen. Well, and just because you got a Bible verse to back up what you just said, don't make you right. Because if you ain't doing it in the right spirit and it don't have the outcome of restoration or reconciliation, you were out of the will of God, because God's never in the business of division. He's never in the business of destroying. So maybe now we can step back and evaluate and examine our words. So we can say something to somebody, we can hurt them. We can say something about somebody, and we can hurt them. We can say something in front of somebody. I have to be careful sometimes what I say in front of my congregation, in front of kids and teenagers, in front of other people, in front of young men that stay close to me. I want them to be close enough to know that they can feel the flames of hell, but I want them to be close enough to understand that though the flames get high, they can't burn you, and you got to press on. And you want to be transparent, you want to be real, but yet you don't want to be negative and give up hope and be hopeless. Because what happens is when that young person looks up, or that young child looks to us, mom and dad, here we are, we're serving the Lord, and man, we're going to church, but yet we begin to get bitter because we got frustrated. And frustrated is a spiritual word for bitterness. Because you got mad because something happened, so now you just say, I've been frustrated for 5 years. No, you're bitter, friend. Everybody all right? I'm trying to help us here. Trying to help us. So here we get in a place of bitterness, but what happens is we begin to speak. So here that young Christian, or maybe that young convert, or maybe that young person, or maybe that young teenager, they're looking up to that spiritual hero, and they're wondering, and the truth be told, they're thinking, okay, are we in? Are we out? Are we going to make it? Are we not going to make it? But the last thing they need is words to audibly come out of our mouth that discourages them to a place where they think, you know what? It's not worth serving God.
Amen.
I talk a lot about things, and I use this a lot in reference with Brother Daniel. Brother Daniel's pretty much been my left leg, right arm, left arm ever since he's been here. What I mean by that, there's been times where there's been so much going on that I've been on the phone. And if you ever ride with me, if it's silent 3:00 in the morning and nobody's on the road, I still don't pay attention driving.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Shane. God bless you. Thank you for accountability right there. You hear that? But it's another thing if I'm driving down the road, something's going on, somebody's calling me, I got an issue. And then it's another thing if it's a rail issue and I got to think about it, and now I'm getting my feet pressed through the fire. So now, man, I'm driving down the road, I'm getting happy, I'm pushing, I'm gassing. You know, I feel like we're rocking. You ever hear people drive like that? You know, they're riding down the road and they're like, wah, 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 wah. Somebody's over there, I can't believe this going on. Everybody's like, you got one hand on the knee, one thing, everything's going. You know, and you're just over here putting your seatbelt on, holding all the go, oh, Lord Jesus, help me. I never forget one day there was a situation that arrived, and I'll just say this is before I had pastored, and Brother Daniel was with me, and later he told me, he said, as I was listening to you speak on the phone, I was really thinking, Lord, am I doing the right thing? Because he began to examine his own life, because he was looking to me, not that I was his hero, and not that but he was looking to me for guidance. It's times like when I go to Brother Larry and I put my head in his arms and I just want to hear him speak. The last thing I want to hear him say is, it's time to give up, son, or it's time to quit, or it's time to throw in a towel. You got to be careful what you say in front of people. You know, a lot of teenagers don't want to come back to church. Mamas, daddies, they hear what we say in front of them. Be careful what you say. If you keep going down, I want you to go down just a little bit longer, if you will. And the Bible says this. It says, for every beast, verse number 7, for every kind of beast, of birds, of serpents, and things of the sea is tamed, and hath not been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame, for it's an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Therewith we bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. You ever thought about that? You ever wonder how somebody can come and speak so righteous and sing like a mockingbird at church, but then they talk and cuss like a sailor, critical? You ever wonder how somebody can come and shout amen, or some lady can pray and she could be, I just want to thank the Lord for prayer, and then turn around and it don't take her 2 seconds, young or old, no matter who she is, to just rip somebody's heart out because she acts like she knows better than Jesus when he walked on earth.
Amen. Amen.
Evil.
Evil.
And you think, wait a minute, wasn't you the same person that was just at church? Be like, praise the Lord, amen. Wasn't you the same person at church? It's like, I just want to thank the Lord. Hallelujah, amen. You know, the very next week, now you are defeating me.
Right. Amen.
I'm all about this living right. I'm all about, but I'm going to say this too. The Bible says that out of the heart, okay? Out of the heart comes the issues of life. Truth be told, as we speak, you could tell a lot about a person by the way they speak. You say, you don't need to judge me. You're right, I don't need to judge you. But the Bible says that we could tell by what you talk about. How you speak, how you talk, how you carry yourself, how you address matters.
Yes,
we tell about how prideful your heart really is. It's not about sitting up and evaluating. You know, we could probably, truth be told, if you sit back and listen to somebody long enough, and I've done this on a regular basis when it comes to counsel or just listen to somebody, you sit back and listen long enough, you can hear bitterness in somebody's words. You can hear anger in somebody's words. You can hear wrath. And by the way, that's Bible too, friend. Put away all those things. Hey, but when I became away, I put away these childish things. Everybody with me? That's still Bible. When I grew up, I put away childish things.
Amen.
I quit living and talking and acting that way. And some of us has never grown up. We never grow up. We come to church. We get a couple years. We have a few birthdays. We blow out a few candles. We get a little age, some gray hair. We act like everything's fine and dandy. We move on and we look back and say, wow, God was good last year. God was good last year. God was good last year. But we never grow up. You want a good evaluation? How come you're the one that still can't walk into a controversial situation because you're scared of what your mouth might say? I'm giving you Bible, okay? I'm not trying to.
Preach on.
You know why you can't control your mouth? Because you can't control your heart. You know why you can't control your heart? Because you ain't controlling your mind. You know why you don't control your mind? Because you're not the one who has control over your bit. The devil's now having a heyday and he controls everything in your life. The Bible says, y'all stay with me tonight. Now, everybody all right? Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I want you to go back, if you will, to verse number 2. The Bible says this, for in many things we offend all. You have to understand that tonight that we have a good opportunity, if you want to say it that way, that we can actually direct our life. Whether you believe it or not, you know, the Bible says that you can direct. You hear me? You can direct your life. You have the privilege and the opportunity to direct your life. By the work of the Holy Ghost and by you controlling yourself, you can direct your life. Who you are, what you're going through, your marriage, your home, your finances, everything that you're facing, the storms. Listen to me. The Bible says, I'm going to show you, you can direct your life. You can make it. You can make it. You can get out of what you're dealing with. You can make it. But he says here in the text, he says, things we offend all if any man offend. In other words, if anybody is caused to stumble, if there's issues, if there's wrongs, if there's problems, if there's a relationship, he said, but if there be somebody perfect, somebody that's mature, what's going on, then you can keep yourself from moving on and making people trip up and things happen. He said, when you grow up and you control your mouth, you'll probably quit falling in as many ditches as you fall into. Let's be honest. How many issues you and I get at work and we get at school, we get at church, that's because of somebody's mouth? And let me just say it this way. How many times have you kicked yourself like I kicked myself because we said something when we shouldn't have said something and somebody heard it, and now we're dealing with something that we said that God told us to keep to ourselves? I'm preaching it plain now, I can promise you. And then we get mad and frustrated. I can't believe I'm doing this. You should have dealt with it with the Lord and kept your mouth shut. Everybody all right? Say amen. I love Jesus. Hallelujah. I mean, God's good. Ain't nothing wrong. Everything's good. But there's people in this community right now that they want to go to a good church. They want a church that's real and genuine. And listen, they're not looking when they walk in. Well, look, they're modest. Boy, they look good in the choir. They're carrying a Bible. Man, they know how to witness and testify and sing. That is not defined to the world as real. That's not. They listen, and I know I'm going to lose some of you here. The world does that when Halloween comes around. They'll put a mask and a costume on all the time. Some of us dress up like Christians, but we don't act like one. Preach on, preacher, preach on. They want to see something real. They want to see somebody that talks right, loves right. And when they say something, they mean it from the bottom of their heart. They don't say, I'm going to lead you, love you, pray for you, walk away. And when you're doubting out and discouraged and ain't got a ride to church and ain't got somebody to call you or care about you, you just push them to the side and move on. No, they want somebody that's real. That's what they're looking for. And he says here, and the Bible says in chapter number 1, verse number 26, if you go back, listen to this. He says, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. He says, if you can't control your mouth, everything you do is in vain. Do you understand the depth of that? If you cannot control your mouth, I'm staying in the text. Everything, your religion, your activities, your participation, it's in vain. Your singing, your programs, your ministry, the way you carry yourself, the way that you do things in the church, the way you help with the King's Kids or the puppet show or the teenagers or the widows or the ministry or whatever it may be, the sound booth. Your ministry is vain. It's worthless to God. God can't use it. Amen. God can't use you. Yes, you can work. But God ain't trying to sign people up to work. He wants somebody to fall in love with Jesus. Fall in love with Jesus. I wonder how many of us, our ministries don't go anywhere and our testimony ain't impacting. You know, one man said it this way, sometimes our gospel don't touch nobody else because it ain't never touched us. Maybe those people that's lost, maybe those friends that we're trying to reach, maybe they're not coming to Jesus because they haven't really seen the gospel change us and we're trying to push the gospel on them. Y'all ever think about that? They're like, wait a minute, I don't know, because right now I'm not just sitting back and questioning you. I'm not just questioning your testimony. I'm questioning your church. I'm questioning the Bible you read. I'm questioning the God that you serve. I'm questioning the practices that you practice. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying to you tonight? I mean, here we got this big hoopla dog and pony show. We want to reach the community. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm all about that. But I wonder how many people down here at the local store hear our music. We pull in and we're getting out. We're singing, you know, bada, 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 you know, whatever it is. I don't know. Some of you got to drive to Statesville and Greensboro and Charlotte to be able to do what you really want to do because you're scared about, thank God that you got enough respect not to do it around here and hurt something. But God sees everything. And you wonder why you're not getting nowhere? You want to know why it's not changing? And I believe you ought to talk to your spouse, and I believe you ought to talk to your friends. I believe you ought to have accountability. Can I get an amen? But just because you talk to, it's like I said it before, if you want honesty, don't ask somebody that agrees with you all the time about everything. If you really want to know what somebody thinks of you, go to somebody that you normally wouldn't ask. I'll go a step further. If you really want to know, go to Brother Shane Hatch and say, Brother Shane, yeah. Can we talk for a minute, Brother Shane? What do you think about me? Amen. Well, since you ask, brother. I love Brother Shane. Listen. I'm not what he wanted me to be, but I'm a lot better than where I was. Somebody say amen. Amen. I mean, man, he's called me out about the way I dress, by the way that I talk. I remember I got saved. And me and Tiffany started dating. I tried to be this Romeo and try to sing at the Dixie Classic Fair. He's like, bless God, singing that country song to her, you know, amen. I was like, man, I'm just trying to be a nice guy, you know. He didn't have no cussing, no fussing, no nothing, you know. I used to have a guy I used to catch chickens with. He used to tell me, he said, you know what happens when you give up country music? He said, you get your dog back, you get your wife back, you get your job back, you get everything back. All country music about everything I lost. I can't believe I lost everything. I'm just kidding. Stay with me. I want you to see this. I want to hurry tonight, if you will. He gives two different illustrations. The first thing he talks about is the horse, and then he talks about the ship. The horse, he says in verse number 3, he said, behold, he said, we put bits in the horse's mouth and they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Right. 1,000 to 2,000 pounds, a massive beast. The Bible says that it can be in control and be usable. Right. As long as a bit is in its mouth and able to be controlled. I've used this illustration many of times, but you see farmers and different people that have used horses. You see people that have rode horses and kids that ride horses. I know Miss Brooke has a love for horses, and I know Jessica Beams had a love for horses. Different people, listen to me. They're never going to jump on a horse that's never been broken. It don't make sense. Why? Because it's got to be under control. And by the way, there's not a farmer that's ever going to be able to use that horse until it gets broken. We can never get used the way God wants to use us until we get controlled by our bit. The second thing he uses is a ship. Notice what he says here. This really helped me, and I don't have a lot of time to stay here. Verse number 4, behold also the ships which they, though they be so great, are driven of fierce winds. Yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeneth. He says they are turned about with a small helm. Do you know how big a ship is? Do you know how big and massive? I mean, I know Brother Renee and some of you others have been in the Navy and seen Navy ships and Naval Academy things. And some of you have been on cruises. And whether you went on a Christian cruise, a Carnival cruise, or a Norwegian cruise, or whatever cruise you go on, it makes no difference to me. They are massive. Can I get an amen? Huge. I mean, they got everything from meat and taters and steak and catfish and to basketball courts. And I mean, they've got places you can go sit and everybody sit around and clap. And they got pools here, pools there. They got slip and slides on those things. Everybody all right? I mean, you go on a Disney cruise, I mean, they'll have Mickey and Minnie up there singing M-I-C-K-E-Y. You know, I mean, it's huge. You know what it says? As massive as that thing is, that even in a storm when it is pushed by winds and fierce winds, it's one small helm. And you know what directs it out of the storm? It's not its mass. It's not its capacity. It's the helm. You know, some of us have got a capacity that God can do so much, not only in us, but through us. And look here, and we're still sitting in storms in our life because we're not giving God control of this. God says, if you would give me control of this, I would lead you out of that storm. I wonder how many of us have a storm in a relationship, a storm in our marriage, a storm in our family, a storm in our mom, our dad, or something else, a storm. I wonder how many storms is because of our mouth. God says, I'll get you out of that storm if you'll give me control over this. The words, I hate you, comes out. The words, you don't understand, comes out. The words, you ain't never lived my life, or you ain't my mama, you ain't my daddy, or you're a hypocrite, or, you know, I can't believe you did that, or you make me so frustrated, and you never knew me, or you don't know how I am, you don't know what I go through, you're not living my life. I mean, I've heard so many, and you know how hard that hurts somebody? And the only way to fix it,
yes, sir,
is not by avoiding it, it's by giving God control. control. I wonder how many of you, Miss Deborah, you go ahead and come. I'll give you two more points. Just keep it by. I ain't even got the second point yet, but listen to me. I wonder how many of you have relationship issues right now because you spoke something out of anger. Or you spoke something out of self-evaluation because you were like Peter or Simon and you assessed the problem by the way that you would humanly think and process instead of listen to a divine person. And because of that, you said something with good intentions, but you're still dealing with the same problem because you've never used the same thing that got you into the storm to be the same thing that gets you out of the storm. You know, you'd be surprised if we're just going to somebody and saying, I'm sorry, what really do to them. I'm sorry. I was talking to my daddy last week. And I told him, I said, Dad, I said, I want to tell you that I'm sorry for all of my life that I blamed you for me turning out the way that I was. We were working, he was on tobacco, and he was about 8 feet in the air above me with the backhoe, and I was in the hole. So maybe I thought he was burying me. Like, amen. I'm sorry, Dad. I never... Shut up, boy. Amen. But we had a stopping point. We couldn't do anything. And he kind of stepped off in his turn. And he was talking about something. And I said, Dad, I want to tell you something. I said, you remember last year when I apologized about Veterans Day, how I always try to honor veterans? But you being my father, that I get so busy with the church that I never really called you. And last year I had apologized to my dad for that. You know, when I walked away, my dad and my mom was the reason why I went down that road, because I blamed them, because the hurt that I felt. And I traveled many roads. I caused many scars. I did many things. I said a lot of stuff that I shouldn't have said. No, it was not fair to me that my family divorced. No, it was not fair to me that my mom and my dad was involved in alcohol and drugs. And no, it was not fair to me that I knew abuse. No, I mean, I was a kid. It's not fair to me. But it did not give me the right to speak to them the way that I did. And I was sitting there and I said, Dad, you remember when I did that? I said, Dad, I said, for what it's worth to you, I just want to tell you I'm sorry that it took me so long. You know, over the past 3-4 years of my life, you know, sometimes you just wish you could take back. There's one relationship I got right now. There's really one thing that was a duration of probably 3-4 years and kind of still on it. There was one moment, one day that I can remember approaching this individual that for one time I took the bit off. And I didn't attack, but I spoke my mind. And you know, I did that in the flesh. Because I was hurt. I was hurt. Now, truth be told, that's not enough to justify anything. But I'm not living based upon other people's justification. I'm not trying to make them right. I've got to do what's right for me. I've got a 10-year-old boy, and I've got a wife, and I have a church. But I want my son, when he gets, and trust me, he's not as dumb as what people think. Well, people don't think you're dumb, son. I should have said that. He's smarter than the average bear. Maybe I should put that home. Hey, man, who's been sleeping in my bed? I don't know who's been sleeping. Anyway, y'all ever seen that book? Y'all seen that? Okay. I want one day when he looks at me and he says, Daddy, why? I want to be able to look at my son and say, son, I did my part. I did my best. That next verse, to say it directs, but it also damages. You hear what I said a while ago about how a little fire kindleth a great matter? Listen to me. Do you understand that there's a lot of things that are great? I told my Sunday school class this one time, we were teaching through this. The Chicago fire started with just a little lantern that got turned over. You remember, that's the greatest fire that's ever, burned down the entire place. And it started with one lantern. It wasn't some some meteor that came in and just blew everything up. No, it was one little lantern. Now, I've seen great families come in and out of this church. I've seen great Christians come in and out of this church. I've seen great legacies come in and out of this church. And it'd be damaged because of their speech, because of what they said. The last thing is, it says it determines life. You know, I use the Bible verse in Proverbs 18:21. The power of the tongue. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. You believe that? Say amen. I'm done. Y'all stay with me. So that means death and life, the power of death and the power of life is in the tongue. Everybody say in the tongue. That means you can control. You know, the Bible says that God, when he spoke, let there be light, there was light. He spoke, there was life. When God speaks, there's life. Can I get an amen? When God speaks, there's life. Can I get an amen? When you're sitting in church and it seems like everything's, but when God speaks to you, man, it picks you up and it helps you determine, I can make it. I can make it. It ain't the preacher's message. It ain't the song that's sung. It ain't a mom and daddy. But when God speaks specifically to you, say, I can make it. I can make it. I know I can make it. Because God speaks. But when the devil uses that same instrument, the Bible says that it can bring death. I wonder tonight, by invitation, how many things are dying in our life, including us, by the way, because of a lack of control on how we speak. Maybe how we speak to, maybe how we speak about, or maybe how we speak in front of. Kids, listen to me. If I can encourage you, and you know my heart, I love all of you. Think about how you really talk to your mom and your dad and the people that love you. Why wait till you're 36 years old to have to say you're sorry for something that you thought that they just thought you were sorry for? Why not be humble enough to be able to say, now I know what we say, but you don't know what they did. I'm not looking at that. Hey, listen, I love my daddy. I didn't tell you about how he done this to me and how he done that to me and how he wouldn't let me do this. I can give you a pity story. I can give you endless nights sitting outside of my house and not able to get in. I can give you bruises and beats and broken stuff. Bottles and pills, needles. I can go through story after story after story. But it's no excuse. It was my excuse for a long time. You listen to me, I'm telling you. You listen to me. And there's young Christians in here. It's not a mom or dad. There's probably people in here. I wonder, you take Miss Jessica and Brother Junior and some of these singles that are sitting back here, some of these young adults. I wonder how many of them that we want them to be more than maybe what they are. We're not criticized. But maybe it's been a long time since you just went by and said, hey, I want you to know something. I still notice what you do. I appreciate you still coming to church. I told Miss Brittany a couple weeks ago, you remember when you was in the choir? So I was glad you was in the choir. You know, it just hit me. I noticed she was out of the choir. You know what? But if God told, and that wasn't me, God told me to say that to her. God, you know what God says? God says, I notice when you're there and when you ain't there. That ain't me. You'd be surprised at what God could do with people if we'd be an instrument that God could use. Father, I love you. May you give us a humble spirit. May you allow this to be a time of restoration. Not just hearing the word, but God, that we would act upon this word. To our God, that we would make something right if it be wrong. And God, even young adults, young teenagers, children, moms, dads, people in the church, that maybe we can assess, evaluate, examine our own words, and maybe today get victory. Allow life and power to be able to come back in the way we speak instead of bringing death and sorrow to people. In Jesus' name, amen. As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. But the great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now, the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, that the world through Him might be saved. That means that God sent His Son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God Himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that He tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? When I ask you, would you trust in Him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent His Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept Him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.